Good evening and Happy New Year. 2018. I have a senior and she's counting down. Task force engaged with many areas of the Every Student Succeeds Act to arrive at the place we are today. We reviewed 5 DC citywide report cards, discussed the park assessment, and examined the 2016 equity report. We also had ESSA reporting by OSSE and discussions about a city report card, the STAR framework, and the word equity. Within our community, we engaged in focus groups to gather data on what district parents, students, educators, and community members wanted to see on a citywide report card. And thanks to the task force members and OSSE, over 1,900 community members responded. The data from those meetings have been recorded and the results will be shared this evening. We will have an opportunity to participate in small and whole group discussions at the end of OSSE's presentation. I have 2 announcements. First, you will have opportunities to provide feedback today, but if you would like to provide more, you are welcome to attend and testify at the State Board meeting on January 17th. Encourage your networks to participate in this meeting as well. To submit testimony, email sboe@dc.gov. Second, Amon Payne no longer attends a public school, and so will unfortunately no longer be part of this task force. We intend to find a new student representative from the State Board Student Advisory Committee. And at our January 17th meeting, we will recognize Ms. Amon Payne for her service to the task force. I'm happy to welcome task force members and OSSE Chief of Staff Shauna Young and her colleagues Justin and Naomi to present on the report. Thank you.
Responded to some feedback and some next steps. That works. Yep, we're on like a long table. I'm gonna try and like get a view of the room. I don't think I need to stand, but I will try and use my projecting voice, and if it's helpful, I can get up. We're a little off center, but we wanted to just talk about our progress, updates to the content proposal. As you've heard some last month, and we got feedback, and so we've tried to listen to that feedback and make a couple updates, talk a little bit about what's going to be coming next as we move forward with some of the format options and some of the next steps. So, this is an update on our process in terms of how we've been coming with information and having task force assist us in getting feedback from the community. And I know it has been a... If you guys... You gotta unmute them. You just need to unmute us.
It's because they're showing you on Wi-Fi. It's taking off the Wi-Fi connection to this Polycom.
But computers. Okay.
Stand up.
So, I think. Is there anyone on the phone?
Everyone is on mute.
information we have and take from you feedback from you individually and from your constituencies to provide information that's going to feed into the type of content and information we want on a report card geared towards parents and families. We completed our first round of feedback right before the holidays, which is, you know, focused on the question in phase one, what information do parents need to be informed to make decisions about their child's options and deepen their engagement with their kid's current school. So we're moving soon to a bigger question of once we have the information we want to start with, at least in this first round of a report card, how are we going to organize it, make it accessible to families, and make it presented in a way that is visually understandable and in a way that in language that people from across the city using it for different reasons can understand. And that's what will be coming to the task force and to various other outreach avenues next. And we're excited to get that kicked off. And then finally, focus on a successful launch. It will be published a year from now in December 2018. And we want to make sure people know about it, that they can click through, that it's not going to be some dead document on a website somewhere, and that all of us in our communities can be using it in all the different ways that we've talked about using it. So we'll want your engagement there as well. And so this is just the bigger picture that we're working towards, a bigger picture towards having having one piece, one set of information about all schools in DC with common information for families to start with, and then to move on to their conversations that are happening in the school with their educators. So with your help, we have done a lot of engagement. As Lynette mentioned, we've heard from nearly 1,900 parents. Thanks to all of you who have engaged using our tools with your community groups and with advocates and families that you know. You can see here a lot of this has been done in person as well as some canvassing efforts and work we've done. If any ever ran into any of you at EdFest, we were pulling people in and recruiting them off of the state board's table to come take some surveys, handing out a little Starbucks gift card here and there, and generally trying to cast a wide net to get feedback on the things that they and we think are important. So we put together, as you know, I think you saw last time, an initial content proposal based on that engagement. We talked about what the top themes have been in parent engagement and other important themes as well that we've heard from specific groups of parents or from themes and groups of families that we thought were really particularly important to target. And obviously included all the required data points. And we also asked, so we've also heard back that we are looking, that folks had even more feedback on our initial presentation and on our initial thoughts about what we thought would be responsive to that feedback. So we wanted to share what we think, you know, some of our responses could be to that, and then thinking about also what other conversations we want to facilitate together that are not just going to be finished now, right, and that really deserve more conversation together. So there's particular areas in which we heard last time as we went through like our first round of proposals. How many people were here last month to hear that? Most? Half? Ish? Half-ish? Okay. So this is somewhat responsive to a previous conversation, but I'll try to recap it as we go, right? We heard a lot from parents and families across the city, particularly of interest in teacher data and in parent and family engagement. And there were some other important themes that we collected as well that we are coming back with more ideas on that we think will better complete a more well-rounded report card. So we're bringing you today updates to the content proposal for the topics that will be included in the first round report card published a year from now. The idea that we're going to work to publish this first round, and there's a couple more decisions that we need to make that might take a little longer or have some other things on the drawing board for future years. So as many of you know and contributed yourselves, many people who are using a report card are really interested in a variety of teacher information. and a variety of ways to measure it, some of which exist at the statewide level that ASSI collects, some of which don't, and some of which are harder or easier to accomplish. We presented last time we were here a proposal that included some measures that we thought were responsive to parent feedback, including qualifications of educators in terms of certification and credentialing, and proposed to share a metric of the number of educators who were inexperienced in a school, which would be like a novice teacher of 1 year or less experience. And what we heard was that folks didn't think that gave a full enough picture and were interested in more information. So one of the things we're coming back and proposing for a next round, and we've shared this a little bit at the Stable working session as well, is to share a more robust set of educator qualifications by talking about the percent of teachers in a school by band of experience. This is information that schools have and share, and so we do think it is collectible and shareable in this first year, which is important because we need to make decisions on things we can deliver. And that does respond to parent and family interest in knowing the spectrum of experience of teachers in a building. So when folks, this is not gonna tell us everything about a school's entire set of teachers, but gives a sense of how the range of experience and the percent of teachers with a range of experience in a school. It's not quite the same as our retention number, but it does give an idea of how many experienced educators and what level of experience are in the school, regardless of if they just got there or if they've been teaching for a long time but just joined the school. And so we thought this was a responsive way to provide more information in a way that we could deliver in a short term, based on the feedback that we heard from you all and from other folks, to say that like our initial novice teacher didn't feel like quite enough, and thought that this was a respectful way of sharing information about teachers that was easy to understand also, and that would be meaningful to families who are looking at schools. There is other interest in more teacher information, and I think there was a robust conversation about this here last time. And we actually at ASSI think this is really important. We actually at ASSI do a lot of work on educator, effectiveness, on educator support, and not all of that is going to be able to be displayed in a metric on a report card, but we'd like to have more conversations and think that the ESSA task force is a important place to be doing that. And we'd like to facilitate further conversations and bring our agency and our school colleagues to the table to talk more about what educator information looks like in the city and how we could be talking and learning more about it and making it more available to families. So as part of this, we'll propose to the state board, we'd like to propose this expanded metric about teacher experience, but also to come back to the ESSA task force if you all will have us, to facilitate some broader conversations about this topic. Because I think, as we talked about last time, educator experience and performance and effectiveness and supports look different across the city, purposefully in all different kinds of schools, and as well as at the state kind of supports that we provide, we'd like another chance to share that. So we're proposing that as well. We can finagle ourselves onto the agenda. The other thing that we heard significantly, I think, from parents and families is that they want more information about how schools are engaging parents and families, which makes a lot of sense if you're a family trying to engage in schools and learn more about them. We had proposed originally links to school engagement plans and or the PTO and PTA. We did this purposefully as a way of trying to create a little bit of a soft accountability. Candidly, that like if you put something on a report card, it means you think it's important, and we think it's important that schools have these policies. We're not going to write them for our school, but we do believe that it should probably exist, and we would like now schools have an opportunity to link to those policies.
Can you tell me what, in fact, might have come out of this conversation where we want to know more about parent engagement?
talked to parents and families, it was a very diverse conversation, but many parents and families said that they are interested in knowing how schools engage with them, how parents engage with schools, what level of engagement there is, and by that, I think if you talk to 25 people, you would get 25 answers or possibly 26. What efforts schools make or requirements schools make in engaging families. So granted, we're talking to families and engaging them in this process, so you would imagine these are families who have questions like that because they're opting into this conversation with us. But candidly, Dr. Hentz, this was a very broad conversation, right? That everybody sort of felt a little bit differently and would name slightly different things if asked. But it was clear that parents are interested in some access or entry point into that information for a school that they would be looking at. We also felt that because of the diversity of questions and interests, it's very hard to collect something that's going to be a number or a bar chart to express this to families. And as some of my colleagues that I've been talking to in the past couple of weeks on the task force have mentioned, there's nothing that's going to take the place of a parent actually engaging in a school to really get the look and feel of what that is. But nevertheless, as I mentioned, I think that having something on the report card denotes that it is important to us and it is important to the people we talk to. So we wanted to think of a way that we could begin to have that entry point for families into this conversation in a way of information that we could collect and it would feel that it would be accurate and feel authentic to families coming in. So this was the problem, I guess, that we were faced with. So, and we asked, and candidly, there was a lot of conversation here and feedback to us, like that just did not feel like enough, right? Like a link to the policy did not feel like it was enough. So what we're going to propose is a series of sort of survey questions with links to further information that give families more information up front in a portfolio of answers. So they would include who or where is a parent point of contact for the LSAT if it's a DCPS school, or the parent representative on the public charter school board. So there are people, right? And who are they? Or how do we get, how to find those people? Do you have a parent organization that meets at least monthly? Yes or no? And how do we get to, how do you get a quick connection to them? Get happy to click, to do social media links. And then also, do you have a written policy that outlines expectations for the school, faculty, staff communication with parents? So is there a parent and family engagement policy at your school? And this is one that we also had some conversation about. I think OSSI's interested in working with some of our partners who do this work and best practices in schools to invest some resources in sharing model best practices for this. We don't want a school rushing out to like write something if this isn't, if by chance this is something they have not spent a lot of time doing. We don't want somebody rushing out to like download something and create it and post it without some thoughtfulness. So we'd like to help facilitate what some model best practices are, so that people don't accidentally create something that is either punitive or not particularly helpful, etc. And we know most of our schools are very thoughtful about this, but and many of them, maybe not, I don't know. We hope that most of our schools are thoughtful about this, I'll change that. But we also like to provide some resources for this, right, to help folks improve and or to give them some thought partnership or support in creating policies for that. I think these are, right now, the draft language we would consider using, but we would want to get input from our LEA and school partners and or folks here to make sure that this language feels like the right thing, or if this one word is interpreted differently at the school level or LEA level, we don't want to create the wrong brain size, but this is basically what we're thinking. And this gives an opportunity for schools to show their suite of entryways for family engagement in a way that is accessible to families. And again, knowing, as a wise woman I talked to in the past week, that none of this is going to preclude a family actually engaging with the school to give them the full information they need. But we want to make it easier to start that engagement. So this is what I was just talking about engagement policies. So we also talk to students, which is almost always the most fun part of the engagement work. We talked to a few different, we talked to the State Board's Advisory Committee and the Youth Advisory Board at the Department of Health. We've heard many of these sessions, what some students are interested in around what else is, you know, extracurricular activities offered, academic rigor and homework load. I don't think we'll be able to include that homework load metric, although that might be a fun hackathon idea for students one day. Different kinds of school environment and food, really. I think a lot of these were high schoolers, so although it might be important to all kids, really. And many of these data points were overlapping with the top themes overall. So these are sort of unique things that came from students, some of which we think are gonna be more included in some of the metrics we're talking about, and some, like I said, are a little harder to accomplish. So we are also, based on feedback from students, but also from folks here and from our engagement, broadening the school program information that we make available. So we heard a lot. We had proposed to have some extracurricular activities and as options, and we heard feedback like, no, we really want as much as you can get on here about whether or not schools provide this information as a complementary sort of like understanding of what's going on at a school that's going to go along with the rest of these. So we're proposing to include these, which are generally collected in other avenues as well, but we think will be really helpful to families who are looking to get a sense of programs. We made a special effort to engage with families of students with disabilities, particularly through engaging with the Association of Special Education, or DCASE, the Children's Law Center, and parents representative from these organizations of students with disabilities. And we made that choice particularly because we know that there's a significant number of students in our schools whose parents are looking for particular information based on their students' needs, and we wanted to make sure that we captured that feedback and tried to figure out what we could do to support it. So folks were interested in a variety of different things, some of which are really, would consider sort of like collectible data, and some are really more programmatic offerings. And there's a couple of different ways that we think we'll be able to be responsive to this. But some of it had to do with sort of wraparound services and staffing at a school. Others had to do with particular detail on IEP implementation and or environments. So for special education, we actually are proposing to consider future state inclusion in a report card, but not for the next upcoming year, because much of this, we have the beginnings, the foundation of collection of it, but not always at the school level, and schools have not totally vetted it in the way we would need to in order to implement it for this coming year. But we're very interested in pursuing these things, and we would propose to engage our some of the same groups we did to begin to talk with them further, as well as focus on schools to get this on a report card in the future. We think this stuff is quite important, and the two proposed to start metrics that we think are at this point the most viable to begin investigating for like the next year or future year would be for compliance with initial evaluation timeline. So that means how timely are you getting evaluated for an individual education plan? That's a required metric. Schools are required to. There are deadlines for this. in an ideal world, it would all be 100% all the time. But for, we know in reality, our families are concerned about this level of service and want to make sure their students are getting the that their needed services in a timely way. Schools are already, LEAs are already reporting on this. It's a important value. And we want to begin to examine what it would take to get this up. As well as there's information for families with students with disabilities around students in the least restrictive environment, which means what percent of students are in general, with students with disabilities, are in the general education setting all of the time, less time, or minimal time. And there's bands that are already reported on this metric. This is not like a rating. It's not like higher is better or lower is better, but it can help a family understand what programs could be possibly available at the school and how students with disabilities are integrated into a school program. Again, this is one we want to do a lot more thinking and talking about with schools and parents together and potentially talk about in what way reporting this could be facilitated in terms of families having meaningful conversations with schools. But this is an area in which we heard feedback from parents that they're interested in this, particularly families with students with disabilities. They're interested in knowing this information so that when they're looking at their own school or other schools, they can see comparable information, or they can compare, if they're looking for a new school, what the spectrum is at that school. Again, I think the reason why we're not saying, like, definitely let's move forward with this year, both of these are ones in which we think there needs to be more information, and we would like to facilitate that conversation with parents and schools together to make it meaningful. But we wanted to reflect it because we specifically are looked for this feedback, and we think it's really important to move forward. But another thing that I think is related particularly to the feedback from parents with students with disabilities, but also actually from parents across the city, was about the availability of health and clinical staff and physical activity time at the school. This is information that we actually do have and we would like to report out on, which is of these like clinical staff that are, some of which are listed here, who does the school have on staff full of part-time? There are some caveats to this. We talked about with schools, but many parents and families are particularly interested in if their student has a particular need, they're very interested in this information. And generally, even for families who may not have a student who, for example, needs to have a medication administered or has an IEP with certain needs, are interested in knowing just generally what kind of services the school has. And then physical activity time. This is one our Division of Health and Wellness is very happy that we're including as well, which is just like how much activity a student gets at school, PE, recess, etc. And I think it's important to show, again, like a well-rounded view of what schools provide. So we wanted to take this opportunity to share these updates that we're planning on providing to the state board, because first of all, your feedback has driven a lot of it, and we wanted to thank you for that, because we do take the opportunity to be here with you really seriously, and I know it's a lot of your time, and we have tried to be very thoughtful about hearing your feedback and what we can do more to be responsive to you guys and to the folks that you represent and the constituencies you represent. So we wanted to share with you those updates when after we brought you the first sort of proposal last month. And so then we just wanted to give you an update sort of on where we are. And hopefully in the next month or two, we'll be able to bring you some like fun, colorful slides with pictures and language and start talking about format and design and things like that. But we have made adjustments to the content proposal in hopes to propose it to the state board for approval. We have sharing that with you and hopefully having further conversation in January and February.
Thank you for sharing, Shauna. We will have an opportunity to break up into smaller groups to
just heard and to comment on it in a way where we can come back as a large group. But if you have any specific questions, burning questions that you would like to ask, please, we can take a minute or two to do that.
A lot of this information that's been added in is self-reported by the school, I believe. Not even a majority, but a substantial amount is self-reported. So what tools does OSSE have in place to sort of spot check data that's submitted?
Mm-hmm. It depends on the data is sort of the answer.
Okay.
For things like programs at a school, we rely on schools to be honest and a lot of public feedback frequently to say, like, yes or no, this is actually happening. I don't think we, like, walk around a school and, like, walk into their, you know, after-school program XYZ. For certain kinds of special education data, we do a lot of oversight and monitoring. And for health, I will have to check particularly on some of the, like, the health information, because that gets collected through some of our like healthy school profiles, and I think depending on which data point, there's various things. I will say, Jack, that this is a constant tension with OSSE, as families want more, and we want more, but we want things on there that are verifiable, and particularly the more sort of high stakes they are, the more or data oriented they are, the more OSSE and OSSE staff feel like they want to make sure, you know, there are more checks and balances in place. So it's a spectrum. Thank you for asking.
More questions?
I have questions on the timeline for what's going before the board on February 21st. If it's just the content, does the board also have to approve what the report card is looking like? Or is it that you didn't come back more for this? Or are you trying to have the whole thing done? Like what it looks like, what goes on page one, prominence, et cetera, all done.
No, we do not plan on having design done. The board votes on the content and the format, but by format, that is, you know, mobile, paper, web, language functionality, accessibility. And we, in our phase two that I got Jakey kicked me off the clicker. Maria. We plan on coming back here and to the public with more design proposals and I guess, you know, for feedback on that part. But what the board votes on is the content and the format, and that's what we will plan on proposing, and we'll discuss it at the January meeting and then again at the February meeting as well.
When they come back with the format, we'll look at it again. Well, now we need to go back out to our communities. Yes, the whole purpose is that just like we had 1900 this time, hopefully we'll have more that we can go into the community and get it back. So I'm going to take two more. And so, Josh, you have Joanna. And then, Allison. Sorry, Allison.
My question to OSSE, my question is based off of the content on slide 30, which is on page 15 of the document, is asking you for a general, how did OSSE arrive at the decision for things to include or not include based off the feedback that you received? Because it concerns me, I guess I would just say the reason why I'm asking is I'm concerned that in the bottom six, that for the online and in the in-person feedback sessions, one of the things, the bottom six of things that I assume that you're putting them there is like things that they care about the least, is the star rating. So I am concerned on multiple different levels of like, one, what was the quality of this data collection, because it seems to me in all the in-person sessions that I had when we talked about and laid out the report cards, where did their eyes go to first? We asked parents, and they all went to the overall rating first. So I see in the bottom six star rating, but I also, it seemed like though you used this information to really impact what changes you wanted to make, but I didn't see in here that you wanted to make a recommendation of removing the star rate.
No,
so my question to you is, like, what was the OSSI sort of, like, general, like, how did you use this information, process it, and then make these recommendations?
Right, so I want to clarify a little bit about what you're looking at, Josh, because what you're looking at here in terms of top three, top and bottom.
It's in the appendix.
Yeah, no, sorry.
It's
this is a different set. What you're looking at is a asking people to say, of the things that are required to be on the report card, which of these do you feel the strongest about and the least interested in? So all the things on here are issues that are required to be on the report card and will be on the report card. And so what we did in our engagement, the reason why this is slightly confusing is we did a couple of things in one round of engagement. One is to ask, and we did this in this room, I think in one of the first meetings, and we got your feedback actually to clean it up a bunch. Based on your feedback, we changed the way we framed it. One is, all the things that are required as a parent or somebody interested in the survey, what are you the most interested in? And that varied a lot. There were some trends, as we saw here, and it varied a lot by the audience, like high school, families of high schoolers are interested in graduation things, families of preschoolers, less so. But those are all things that are required to be on no matter what.
So the things on the top end are also required?
All of them, everything on there.
School-related or less are required to be on the report card? College enrollment is required to be on the report card?
If available, yeah, through ESSA.
Okay.
Yeah, all of these things are required. There's a lot in ESSA is required.
Yeah,
but that's actually one.
That helps me understand that piece, but it seemed as though you still use this information to make those suggestions, so I want to...
Well, what we're suggesting here are things that are beyond generally what's required, or based on feedback, people are asking for more. So that's where the conversation... We wanted to get both senses to help us, to help ground ourselves as to, like, what information should be at pro on more. But largely, the things that we're talking about, like adding here that we heard feedback on, were things that were not necessarily required, or that parents pushed us to go beyond what is required, or families or you were pushing beyond what is required. What more could you add? And so that's largely what we've been talking about last month and this month, which is we know there's a bunch of stuff that's required. We're going to have to do that. We may or may not know exactly where and how, but it'll all be there. And here's some more things that we'd like to make it effective.
Okay, so can you make
a quick question? In what you'll be proposing, I guess, for the state board to vote on, I know we've talked about making things mobile friendly. I have a few parents in mind in particular who really want there to be an app, so I'm just wondering if that's going to be something specific. Like not just so they don't have to like scroll, because they were saying like trying to scroll the site sometimes on the phone. Make it mobile friendly. So I was just wondering if that was. I got specific requests like make it an app.
That I have not heard before, and that is super, super interesting.
Okay.
So
I wrote it down and I
duly noted. I have not looked at every single piece of feedback, so that is fascinating. I just wanted to add also, and I quickly, all the list of the entirety of like required plus new is in the appendix here. I just wanted me to point it out. So we talked about like what's new, what's different here, but the whole list, including the new and changes things, is in there, and we'll be happy to send it around.
Thank you very much.
But even if it's not an app, it being Facebook, like if it could be on Facebook, that'd be another way of having it accessible for them as well.
Yeah. So those these okay. Some of the things that you all are bringing up right now, you have an opportunity with this next as we move forward. To talk about it in the small group and then come back and put down your burning issue of what you would like to say. So as of right now, I would like to thank John and her team for presenting and move on to the next part of the report card to our small groups. And so we will now break into small groups to provide feedback on what you just heard. And if you notice, we have the small group questions up on the board, and that there will be some in the rooms that you are going to. So what I'm asking is that each of you look at the color sticker that is on your name tag. If you have yellow or green sticker, please follow Maria to the breakout room.
And if you have orange sticker, could you please meet to the front? And you have blue sticker. If you have blue sticker to the front, if you have orange sticker to the back. And there will be a sheet that has the questions on it, and you will have 15 minutes to talk about it.
I'm like, I wish that was
quicker to balance.
Have a return to the right and to break up the communication. I appreciate this feedback. So this So
gives you more information.
Did those feel responsive to like what they were expecting in the teacher discipline data, or are we moving in the right direction? Are things missing?
I think we are moving in the right direction.
From what I see in terms of the teacher data, I feel like they tried to get creative in giving information based on a limited ability to do that. So, like, without having easy access to, or easy ability to put out some of that teacher quality, they tried to put in some parameters that still gave parents some information, even though they couldn't give them everything.
Sure. The red font means things that change from version 1 to version 2.
I'm really tired. I'm sorry.
That's good.
I know some things that are just pragmatic, before and after care. And then I know it won't happen until.
So, questions, concerns, other questions or concerns?
So, for context, I am not Maya Martin. I work for PAVE now. I'm PAVE's new policy analyst. I'm Perry Savage, but Maya is on a plane to LA right now, so I'm standing in for her. And so one thing that I believe you did a lot of work, right, with Maya on this, in terms of getting feedback. So just one thing that I was going to point out about the we've been about so much tonight.
Actually, this just in the last one, the wrap and rail services.
And I did it. You're at a high school, so that is very important. You guys,
those are not.
I have an elementary school, so of course, graduation rate was not as high with us. Special education was very important. I'm east of the river. I'm at a charter school and stuff like that. So special education was very important. What type of services that they provide, because you're east of the river where a lot of those services are east. So those were the things that were really important as far as really understanding, making sure that IEPs and everything like that are implemented and stuff. Because a lot of times they've been at schools and they really have been unable to articulate that their child may need special things. And so, or they may be embarrassed too to say that their child needs. So they want to be able to see if the school offers what their child has to, with them actually having to go to people and say, well, my child has this, you know, and I've come all the way to the school to find out, do you offer these type of services and what type of services do you offer? So something that speaks to that, that allows us to, you know, kind of look at a school and say that, yes, we offer, you know, things for special education or meet those needs was important.
No, I mean, I actually was struck conversely to that, because I look at it as like, I may not offer it, but I'm a public school, and if a student wants and they need it, I'm required to do it, so I'm going to do it. And I don't want for an advocate or anyone else to look at that information and say, oh, well, they only have, you know, they don't have, I'm trying to think of one right now, like, okay, so I don't have any student right now that gets physical therapy. I'm in high school. Physical therapy is oftentimes done at younger ages. It just happenstance right now. I don't have a physical therapist. I never have one of those service providers on staff. They're always contracted. So I don't have that in my thing, right, in my little, you know, because I can't check a box with Aussie saying I've got a contract right now to do that. So a parent sees that. Does that somehow actually truncate or limit? So I'm actually viewing it just subtly different. I'm saying, like, right, no, not that it may hurt, but rather, we are required to offer the services that are in the child's IEP. So if a student comes to tomorrow and needs physical therapy, I have to get physical therapy for that student. I don't have a choice. Right? Just because I don't have that service currently doesn't mean I will not offer it if someone comes to the door, because I'm required to and I want to meet that requirement. Does that make sense?
So I think that I'm all for transparency. I do hate, though, the idea that we would get so fine, you know, so detailed that we would provide this sort of picture that that is the universe of the school, and that it doesn't expand or, you know, change based on what the student needs. That's actually what we do at this point. We are a 400 kid high school only. Like, we don't always offer or have that one thing that you need.
But
it will happen if we need it, right? So. That was my only strike. I think it's great to have it on there, but it did sort of strike me as we were talking that, like, there's a downside to this. When parents are really looking at it, that's what was also interesting is, like, the special education measures that were in there. I think it's good that it's on there, and so it's almost like I would answer all it's responsive, but the question and concern I have is, like, how do we ensure that those measures are not viewed as a limiting factor for families? And so, like, if a family looks at it and says, like, oh, 90% of the students in this school actually are, or 95 are mainstream, or whatever terminology you want to use, like, they're in the general educational setting for 90%+ of the time that they're in school, that a family that needs more doesn't actually say that's not the school for the kid, right? Because they still may have the same aspirations for their child to go to college. They may align philosophically with that school's mission. It may be the right school for that student. Just because they're part of the 10% of students that don't, like, that aren't sort of the norm, would that be a way that somebody might look at the school and say, oh, that's not the school for my kid, when in fact it could be? And I think that as we get more and more detail in what it is that we're presenting on the report cards, we run a higher risk of that happening, because families will use what's on a piece of paper instead of using, I'm going to use my 2 feet and go to a school. I'm going to actually experience what that's like. I'm going to go and ask the questions. So,
yeah. I wrote that down as an also, that the special education data might be blurry and the city that's not something that we practice, but you practice it. It's just not at this moment.
And I think it just needs special attention paid to it, right? That we always keep in our back of the mind that for everything that we're being transparent about, it can also be viewed by a rental consumer or any consumer as a, well, this is a violation of law. What do you mean you don't have a PT? Well, hold on. That's not what we're saying here. You know?
So we have, like, one more. I put teacher data as one of responsive things. I don't know if everybody agrees.
I agree. I also think it was really good because, like, teacher data in charter schools is tricky because we are not required to have certifications and licensure. And so I thought it was good to have a way in which families felt like they could have information about teacher qualifications that would be universally accurate. So I thought that was a good measure for them.
And then what would be a second one?
But teacher data is already the one that's don't, because, like, we don't usually meet during the summer months. You usually don't meet during December or just for January, like, because of breaks and all things. So I think I would tweak some of that language. But I think in general it is sort of trying to make the measure of response between what we have and can give versus overkill.
Their form of parent engagement may be, and if our school
everybody's going to start coming back in a second.
There are multiple meetings. I can help you find the right one. And if we can finalize, we're going to move back to our groups.
Two items of the report card that feel most responsive to Keen's needs. So we had emphasis on student achievement, so also looking at test results, but also where that felt right. Two, teacher, on the teacher data element, so making possibilities out of what is currently available. And the special education pieces are important along with childcare. On top questions going forward, so
this was specifically from the representative from PAVE. So parents are looking for ways to interpret the information that they see. So how do parents know if something is good? So benchmarks, averages, how do you give context around that? Field trips and like other opportunities for children might be something important. How does STAR and sort of PMF, how does that align? What's the future of those? And then for additional measures, field trips and opportunities, and I don't think we mentioned this. Maybe we're not. Okay.
Thank you.
I do all right?
Yeah. About the orange group.
Somehow showing like PTOs, parent-teacher nights, any way that, you know, parents are involved. We did discuss how sometimes they can show parent involvement through robocalls, but I think we really want more substantive parent involvement other than that. So those are the two things, teacher data, parent involvement. One person mentioned, or two people, special education data, but that also drew concerns with special education data. That focusing on services like special education services that the school may not practice currently, but can provide. So when they collect the data, you know, we want people to be careful that they're not saying that the school is not providing services, so parents might think that those services won't be provided. So being careful with the special ed services data and inaccuracy of data reporting. So those were the two. Additional things, we wanted them to think about student experience and cultural environment. That's a big thing, especially in high school. And then more extracurricular and educational opportunities on the report card. So the ones we have now add more to show kind of the student experience.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are two things that we thought that were most responsive to our community sessions that we attended. It was the inclusion of program options at schools, and also something about parent engagement and the level of support that they get from the school. Our top two questions or concerns about the report card that we heard from our communities was one that, like, just the flat 4, 5, 6, 3, 2 stars, whatever, that wasn't necessarily the best way to talk about school quality, that there were potentially other ways in which, like, if the school isn't a 4, why aren't they a 4? So were they're concerned about it being a focal point too much so. And then another thing that we talked about is that seemed to be somewhat responsive, but just continue your question, to come from a perspective of positivity rather than negativity. We did see that, at least for like teacher experience, that it wasn't like percent of teachers who weren't experienced, it's percentage of teachers who are experienced. So just continue to focus on that. And then the two additional measures that we'd like to see, one is school climate. And then we also talked about that we know that there's access growth, but also potentially looking at what percent of kids actually are able to transition out of ELL services, and also what percent of kids are actually able to transition out of special education services.
Mm-hmm. And so we now have a green group?
Yeah.
Great.
So the two items at the top are the most responsive. We have the health data, and the teacher data. So it was also said that just kind of overall, the overall required information is what it wants. Top two questions or concerns. I think similar to the first group, what are we doing to educate parents on the metrics, i.e. like what's the definition of bullying? So that parents understand how that number is being created and reported. And then kind of to our initial conversation, how are we going to
deal with self-reporting and the verification. You know, will it be indicated on their report card which data is self-reported? Important additional measures. Speaking about the future, so really trying to get at some of the nuances of schools when it comes to special education, like their philosophy, so that parents can maybe have good choices. So I think it was also brought up, maybe it's just that we need to help educate parents on the types of questions to ask to get at that when they are interacting with the school. Maybe that's not the report card, but just trying to figure out, like, that it's going to be, it's a tough one to look at, how schools deal with special education and finding the right fit for you and your child. And then kind of similar with parent engagement, that recognizing the difficulty with kind of trying to compare how schools interact with parents, and that kind of philosophy and attitude. It can't always be measured in numbers or parent groups or things like that, but that doesn't necessarily mean schools not engage with families. So how do we begin to explore how to kind of get into that deeper question so that parents can, again, find the right fit for them in terms of how engaged they want to be, how willing the school is to engage with them.
Thank you. Thank you. This information, you all will receive it, so that, and so will Aussie, so we can take you on, so we can move to the next step. So as of right now, I would like to give you all an opportunity to share any feedback that was not captured by your group and report out. Just take 3 minutes. That's maybe in front of you. That has been passed out. So please complete it, and the state board will be giving your feedback for consideration. And once we finish with that, we will move into the national plan. Thank you, Principal.
It is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, like,
All my life. lives in the building. First, as I went as a school psychologist, then morphed into the special education coordinator, and then into an assistant principal, and now in acting lead of the school. I'm sorry, could you move
on? As you think about your leadership and leadership in general at a school, what's made the difference so that your school has been able to be successful on paper and to the community?
So for me, the chief thing is loving what you do and loving the students. As far as I'm concerned, that is the most critical thing, to allow the students to be the ones who drive what you do, because that's the reason for being there. And that's one of the things that I ensure that I do. I think my staff is very, very, what they know, that it's going to be about the students. And so that's what I do.
Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Maurice Harbour. I am the principal over at Friendship Chamberlain. I've been there now 8 years as principal. I started my teaching career in New York City as a mathematics teacher. So I figured what I bring to education is the fact that I've been able to be relatively successful in public school setting, private school settings, and now in the charter sector. I think throughout my career, what I've been able to experience is a level of just understanding and patience when it comes to education, just knowing that you know, you're not going to be successful overnight. It takes time to actually get there. And to answer the question, I think you know, the important factors are, as an administrator, as a leader, is just really focusing on the teachers, because having teachers create happy students, and happy students, you have happy parents. So it's that circle that just keeps going. And those are some of the components that we use to really hone in on success at Frontier.
Hi, everyone. My name is Richard Pullman. I am the executive director of a very small LEA. We have under 400 kids. And so while I am not a principal, we actually don't have a principal at TMA. We have an executive director and head of school, and we share a lot of the same responsibilities. And where our roles really differ is I don't go into classrooms and coach teachers, but I do go into classrooms and observe instruction and give feedback, but I don't sort of coach teachers. I'd say that is the main difference between what the principal or the head of school and myself do. But really, I sort of touch most things that happen throughout the school. So I come to the school leadership through working as a lawyer previously, and so now I'm at a legal-themed school. But before I was a lawyer, I was a teacher in elementary and middle school. And I would say that the leadership for me really comes down to active listening, and that sort of stems all throughout the building. Teachers, families, students, being in a high school, there's a lot of student voice, an active student voice. And so always listening before making a decision about something, I think, is really what we try to do to make sure that everyone feels heard. We may not always agree, but we can agree that everyone has the opportunity to be heard.
I know that part of Dr. Woodruff's idea was for the task force to be able to hear some good practices and to hear from folks who have been successful. I'm a former principal, and I used to have a book on my bookshelf that was called "If You Don't Feed the Teachers, They'll Eat the Students." And I think that really sort of sums up the idea about leadership. In my experience, is really that we're caretakers, and whether it's surfacing student voice, as is so important at that level, whether it's the expertise that we gather and we're able to bring to bear in our community, or the sheer care that we have about our jobs, I think these are among the things. We have questions from the task force about leadership and about how good leadership makes a difference in the school.
I mean, I know that I do
They get Josh Booth, executive director of Empire K-12, and Dr. Reed, and Corey. I don't know if you know that. We do the Bold Performance School Awards every year, and both of you, we recognize your school for being able to be a school that excels and beats the odds for kids that serve low-income kids. And that's based off of your performance on Park and how much it exceeded the expectations that we would have been able to bring to those for school. And Corey also is on the ESSA task force for early childhood education, and a parent who attends your pre-K was really positive, so just know that there's good props out there for your pre-K program. But I want to know, what is it that is so special about the work that your staff, that you and your staff are able to do, that it's having an impact on low-income average kids?
So one of the things I have realized is that the cliche is out there, you have to get the right people on the bus.
Okay.
And it is critical that you know who you're looking for based on what your vision is. My vision in that school, I don't care who you are, what you come with, what your challenges are, that's not my concern. From the perspective of being able to help you to reach where you need to go. In other words, that's not a barrier. You know, some people, oh, this is happening, daddy's in jail, mom is, come on. Put that aside and let's get cracking. The kid is here, and our responsibility as a professional is to teach that child. And so you have to be very selective in who comes into your school and what you're really looking for. And in addition, you have to work with families and have them understand at every level what your expectations are and not deviate from them for any reason at all whatsoever. You have to build on a daily basis. For example, reading is critical in my school. As soon as you hit that door, make sure you have a book in hand and that you start reading. I don't have the kids play in the mornings. They come, we all sit in the gym and we read. And I know the all the games and everything are coming in, I confiscate them. And the kids understand that you're doing this because you want them to succeed in life. And so you make sure your teachers are aligned to your vision and that you're working together as an entire team. In my school, everybody's a part of my team. Custodian, doesn't matter, cafeteria staff, everybody is a part of the team. All of our children belongs to all of us, and we're moving in one direction. And so that is what challenges everybody up here and everything else but the child of God. But you just have to be very strong and very focused on what it is that you want and not deviate from that for any reason.
Well, I agree with everything that Dr. Reed spoke to. I think I would add to it that we often don't talk about resources and how we use those resources and how we are intentional about using those resources. And I think that played a role in us creating a level of success. There wasn't an opportunity that presented itself that we didn't sit down as a leadership team and think through what we were going to do with the resources that are presented to us. And when, you know, oftentimes we think about how schools, their resources vary, but at the end of the day, it's what you do with what you have that's important. And I think we did a very good job at that, given the amount of students we have, which is 700, and of the 700, 60% of them are economically disadvantaged. So, you know, it was consistent throughout. We did a very good job hiring teachers that cared about students and retaining them over the years. Definitely being open enough to provide teachers with a level of autonomy that allowed, you know, the teaching practice to be an art as opposed to some rigid, this is a curriculum that you need to follow in order to be successful. So we created that environment, and that's how we build on that level of success.
Oh, I would echo again. I mean, I think Maurice hit a lot on when we think about teaching and learning, right? We actually don't at TMA go into classrooms and say this is what we expect to see in every classroom. We do not have a formulaic way of looking at teaching and learning in classrooms. In fact, they're you know, I've shared the anecdote before of going into a classroom and, you know, comparing the teacher to the conductor of an orchestra, right? I would never have taught a class the way she was teaching it, but it was beautiful to watch. And if you walked in, you may at first, you would not have seen the desks in rows or the objective on the board or some of the things that you might expect to see if you were sort of going through more formalized evaluation rubric, but the learning that was taking place was deep. The connections that students were making to the materials were deep. They were teaching one another the materials, and that depth of learning, I think, only actually comes when you empower the autonomy that teachers can have in classrooms to really move the needle. And then also starting from, and I think this is very important, starting from the time that a prospective teacher walks in your door, testing that person's innate belief that all students can and will learn no matter what. I think you have to test that. You have to test a student or a teacher's resilience to pressures around that, and you have to ensure that the people you are hiring innately believe that, because that will be smelled out by students throughout the building in an instant. And it is the thing that, more than anything, attracts our students to that teacher and allows them to know that person is somebody who cares about them and cares about what it is that they're learning, and that enables them to teach. And so I think we really start with some of those ideas about what does great instruction look like and who do we know needs to be in front of our kids providing that great instruction. So, you know, there are many other things that I think attribute to growth and success where maybe you wouldn't otherwise see it. I think we have an adherence to data procedures that, while I don't care what you're doing in your classroom to get there, I'm going to look at your data with you. And if your data isn't there, we're going to have a conversation. And if the data still isn't there, we're going to have another conversation. And at the end of the year, the data isn't there, then the conversation we're having at the end of that is, thank you very much for your time and service. But so it's autonomy, but it's result focused, and we constantly are analyzing the data.
We'll try to come to more questions on that one, see if we can get to the subjects. School climate, the term school climate is sort of educator-ese for how does your building feel? How does your school feel? What have you done to generate a positive school climate in your community?
We have embraced all of our children and all of our parents. Sometimes, historically, parents do not like to go into schools. Most of our parents sometimes feel like, you know, my population of parents, for example, is very high English language learners. Many of my parents are not able to read or write. And sometimes it's very difficult for them to come in and communicate with staff. And so what we've done is to ensure that we have individuals within the school who are able to speak the language of our kids, one. Two, to have our parents come in and understand that this is your child's school. You have the right to be here. And so we have a lot of parent interaction. My parents do not have to make an appointment to come to the school and go into their child's classroom. The door is always open. You want to come in, all you need to do is sign in with the security officer, and we have a survey that we give to you. Just say, I want to go to my child's class. We give you half an hour. Of course, you know that we change the dynamics in the classroom, so we can't have you ready. But you have half an hour to go in and sit down and observe your child in the learning environment and give us some feedback. I can promise you that we will implement feedback, everything you say, but we look at it and implement if we find that really assists us in moving forward. But it's a
very open environment. Parents can come in. I never close my door. You don't have to make an appointment to come in and see me. So it's just a matter of embracing your families and your students.
I mean, I think from a specific perspective, it was just involving the parents in the decision-making process around a lot of the school culture things. You know, they tend to have different people that they go to in the building in terms of, you know, what their needs are. And we definitely created a platform in which they can bring the needs to whomever, but it still will filter to, you know, the masses or the leadership team. And that allowed us to kind of create a connection between, oh, they are changing the dismissal policy because that's something that, you know, we kind of had a concern about. So once they saw that, once the parents saw that we were listening to some of their concerns and some of the things that were going well, I think the parent culture changed. Within the building, I think we kind of pride ourselves in being able to provide a level of just kind of autonomy to our students in terms of it's not a rigid environment where, you know, the expectation is that, you know, you're always in straight lines and you're always, you know, quiet in the cafeteria and things of that nature. And just making school fun, giving them something to look forward to. Oftentimes, I can tell you a story today. I pulled the entire fifth grade class into my office, and, you know, my office isn't that big, so we're all fitting in there. And, you know, even though I'm, you know, reprimanding them for their behavior in the cafeteria, the conversation was, this is your school. We do not need to behave this way in your school. So, you know, those type of conversations, parents hear me having them, teachers hear me having them, and that's how we got to, you know, that's another way in which we built the culture up.
Well, I oftentimes think about school climate, what our students would say about what we do. And I think that a lot of times our kids comment, we do a lot, right? We hear that over and over again. And the reason why is because our parents and our families, they want a safe place for the kids to go to school. And I think number one for us, when we think about school climate, we want that to be top of the list, right? We want our families to know that we have rules, that we hold people accountable for following those rules. That it's not, you know, we're not always practicing an exclusionary practice, and that has been a big change for us in particular in the last 3 or 4 years. We've done a lot of things differently to keep kids in school while enforcing those rules. But that what remains is that idea that we have rules. When you come in the door, you are greeted by someone who's making sure that your uniform is checked, that you're ready to go for the day. They are enforced with warmth, but that there are very strict lines and that is our climate. I mean, if you walk through our school, I would say that is what our students would tell you, and I would say that's palpable in what we do. It's also palpable into our classrooms, where the expectation is the learning is happening there. We are a college prep school. We talk about college from the first day you start with us, which is a month and a half before other high schools are starting, because our, you know, 90% of our students are coming to us the summer before we actually start school. And that conversation is about college from the third day onward. And so what we talk about is the level of rigor that needs to go on in our classrooms for our students to actually be ready for school. So that's really our school climate. I guess there's a lot of intricacies around the application of those through warmth. But when we think about what we talk about with parents, is like, this is what you can expect from us. We want you to know what you're getting when you are getting TMA. And it's not for everyone, but this is what we have, and this is who we are.
When you hear these folks speak about their individual schools, you can feel so keenly their investment in the identity that they are building for their schools. And I hope that we're all hearing that it's not identical. It's not identical. And that's such an important piece. Well, Richard, you mentioned academic rigor. what becomes complicated with academic rigor is how you balance providing academic rigor for the range of students that you have. Can you say a few words about the academic rigor? How do you define it in your building? How is it experienced by your students?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. I think that I would first say it has dramatically changed for TMA over the past 4 years, and part of that has been moving to becoming our own LEA for special education services. And I think that historically speaking, TMA and other charters who elected to have DCPS serve as their LEA for special education had an opportunity to sort of move students in inter-LEA transfers that we don't have anymore and we don't take advantage of any longer. And so what that has required us to do is actually have really deep conversations about what that means for us. And what rigor looks like when you have students who have intellectual disabilities, when we have students now who, you know, effective yesterday are on a diploma track, are not on a diploma track, who are on a cert track. And that has caused a lot of sort of conversation, tension at times internally, as we sort of move and shift a little bit from what our anchor of rigor has looked like. And so I would say we are constantly growing and evolving around some of the edges, but what we do have core is around our expectations for rigor is that college benchmark, right? And so in 4 years, we know where you're entering and we know what the mark needs to look like in 4 years, right? We know what ACCUPLACER requires. We know what AP courses look like. We know what credit-bearing courses in college look like. And that is really from where we map backwards to ensure that our curricula are aligned to make sure students are ready to access those entry-level credit-bearing courses in college. We are, again, constantly looking at data around passer rates. We're looking at unit. We're looking at making sure that all of our students are able to keep up with that. But that's where when we think about rigor, that's our measures for rigor. Like, what are we setting as the benchmark, and how many of our kids are meeting it, and what is our plan to go back and look at that data to ensure that the most number of kids, students are meeting the rigor benchmark on the most number of items, right?
Well, speaking kind of trend, rigor for us is very, we're indifferent about it. And I'll say, you know, we understand that classrooms need to be performing at a high level to kind of pinpoint how a student is doing. But we also keep in mind, to Rich's point, the varying levels of students that we have. You know, we're looking at, with Friendship Chamberlain, a pre-K 3 all the way up to 8th grade school. So, I mean, rigor varies from grade level to grade level. But when we talk about academics, we really start in having the students own their data and being able to consistently have conversations with them about their data. And then we have, you know, the team in place that has conversations with the teachers about their data. So it's an ongoing cycle that I think is beneficial, because we also celebrate the students that just are not quite where we want them to be, so that they can also feel that need to be there. And I think everyone has some type of achievement that resonates in the different grade levels, and it just continues throughout. And it's no question that success kind of breeds that type of continued success. If you see that, you know, my classmate is doing well, and 90% of the class is doing well, then I want to do well too. And I'm here every day. And these are things that are also important, because we do pride ourselves in making sure that students are in their seats every day. I think that's something that we often lose sight of when we talk about academic rigor and things of that nature. So those are some of the components that we look at in terms of academic.
So I think that my colleagues have spoken to most of as academic rigor is going on as well. And one of the things that popped up to me is student owning their data. Critical. Every student in my school has to know where they are. And And in the park, for example, we have meetings immediately after we get the results to look at where kids performed and what they could have done. I had one kid who missed his advance by 1 point, and he just cannot live it down up to this point. He has settled down so much. He spoke to the chancellor about it because just 1 point. He spoke to the superintendent about the timing of the test. And it's really, I mean, so taken by that, that this year I haven't seen him near my office at all because he's going to get that point and be advanced in both areas. But students owning their data and knowing what they can do to move on. Of course, DCPS defines what rigor looks like in a lot of instances. One thing I don't like to see in my classroom is what you call it, handouts, printouts.
Worksheets.
Thank you, the worksheets. You know, we have all kinds of things around that. But one of the things that we do is we move away from the sage on the stage, the instruction, and we're a small group instruction school. So kids rotate through their teachers at some point in very small groups so that we're meeting the needs of every single child. You know exactly where they are. I have a very large special education population. We have autism, and that comes with a different you know, understanding of what our kids need as far as rigor is concerned. But they're moving along, and many of our kids are coming back from private schools, and I'm just absolutely proud of particularly that program, our prison program, and where the kids are going with inclusion and getting them along the path.
The last topic we want to dive into pretty quickly is around family engagement. Can you highlight something that you did for family engagement that your family would say was successful, and tell us a little bit about why the families felt it was successful? All right, so I'm
sorry. Well, I mean, when I think of family engagement, the first one that comes to mind in terms of something you've done as a community is the school shows that we do. I think, you know, often, the parents will come for the awards assemblies, but they also come for, you know, the performances. And, you know, it's important that they know we're doing more than just, you know, the basics, reading and writing and so forth. But we're also tapping into something that they may have not known about their child, and they are interested in dance, or they're interested in playing an instrument and things of that nature. So those types of engagements are also great, but over the past couple of years, what I've noticed is the social awareness of students and just being supportive of things that they want to do to support things that are going on in the world. So, I mean, you know, those are the type of things that I feel like are impactful to parent and community engagement.
So, all I need to do for parent engagement is to get on the robocall, and I don't have anywhere to put parents. My parents are extremely supportive. Dr. Woodruff has been there on several occasions, and I've seen the level of engagement there. Literacy night, math night, oh boy, you name it, Saturday Academy, and the parents are, they come. They're very, very involved in their school. It's their school that they're very involved. Parent chat.
So when I think about our parent engagement strategies, they are most all dedicated to our mission, which is for college preparation. And getting parents to our school when we can give them the hook of, like, this is, we're asking you to do something to get your kid in college, like, that has been super successful. The one I would pick out of those would be that we, the last 2 years, have taken our family members of our junior class. Last year was more than 65% of our junior class that went on a college visit with their family, with a family member. not everyone. And the idea is that you know, for a lot of our students, they are first-generation college goers, and just you know, having the opportunity to go, the students have a tour, the parents get a separate tour. We have a parent workshop afterwards that sort of allows for families to be having conversations and asking questions in a smaller group of people that go to the same school, their kids are going to the same school with our staff, about what it means for my kid to be going to college in 18 months. So that has just been a really great program, and we've gotten a lot of grant support to do it, thank goodness, because it is costly, but it has been a really great opportunity for us to then kick off the, and here's what the next 18 months look like for you and your student to really get to college, and here's what we're going to do over those 18 months. And I would share one that is just totally off mission is we started doing family game night a year and a half ago, and like it is a large success in that we don't talk about anything academic, nothing. It's just teachers and students and families and staff coming together and playing board games at different tables throughout the cafeteria, and we grill some food, and it's a really wonderful night. It's nothing to do with academics. It's just around community building, and it's a lot of fun actually. Quigley, I think, was one of the things.
I know everybody around the table has thought about our challenge to create the tour as quite a complex task. Well, I want to say I very much appreciate Dr. Woodruff giving these educators the opportunity to come and talk. This is the kind of thing that I love as a head of school and as an educator. The next time that you hear the disparaging remarks about education in this city, don't forget these faces. Don't forget their words, and give support. Volunteer, offer your time, but mostly put out the positive press that there are wonderful things happening for children in this city at the hands of fierce leaders like these. Thank you so much.
But it has to trickle down, because also you empower the children.